Hey guys, and welcome to Amazing Videos! And today I'm going to be reading Chapter 7 of Schooled by Gordon Corman. Here we go! Chapter 7. Name, Mrs. Donnelly. As CAPS caseworker, part of my job was to check in with the school from time to time to make sure he was doing well. That's how I wound up having lunch with Frank Kosigi, assistant principal at Claveridge Middle School. Oh, don't worry about Cap from an academic standpoint, he assured me. He's right up there with our brightest and best. Commune or no, he's been very well educated by somebody. I thought of Rain and shuddered, even after all those years. She had always been the teacher at Garland. For someone who rejected all forms of authority, she was a major tyrant in the classroom. If she hadn't adopted the hippie lifestyle, she would have made a terrific marine drill sergeant. Then Mr. Kosigi let the other shoe drop. Yet socially, in my entire teaching career, I've never met a student who knows so little about ordinary everyday living. Have you worked with any other students from this Garland farm? Only one, I replied faintly. She had a very difficult adjustment. I didn't bother to mention that she was me. Adjustment is one thing, but Cap is a space traveler who just landed on Earth and left his guidebook in the homeworld. Is it possible that he honestly believes bullfighting is a sport we play in middle school? Bullfighting, I repeated. How did that subject come up? His reply posed far more questions than it answered. Apparently, Cap had asked about it as part of his duties as 8th grade president. 8th grade president? How could a brand new student, who didn't know a soul in the place, get himself elected president? It made no sense to me. But later on, my 16-year-old daughter acted like it was the most obvious thing in the world. Duh. 8th grade president isn't an honor, mother. It's like being elected village idiot. Every year they pick the biggest wing nut in the building. It must have seemed like the freakazoid dropped straight from heaven to fill the post. I was horrified. Sophie, that's awful! She shrugged. What's really awful is that you're a social worker, with power over kids' lives, and you have no clue what common knowledge is at school. Did this happen when you were in 8th grade? Remember Caitlin Tortolo? She didn't really win a semester in Europe. She left school early to have a nervous breakdown. And you participated in it? Everybody did, she retorted. At least we did nothing to stop it. If you don't go along with the gag, you're next. I must have looked disapproving because she added, Grow up, mother. The world's a big, tough, scary place. Like you don't know that. Actually, I did know that. I didn't realize she knew it. I felt terrible for poor Cap. It was hard enough for him to come out of total isolation at Garland without having to be dropped into the snake pit that was middle school. Worse, I couldn't even warn him about it, not without poisoning his one and only experience of the real world. My sole consolation lay in the fact that he would have to suffer this abuse only for a few more weeks. His grandmother was recovering well. I'm sure he would have liked to visit her more often. But the facility was an hour away, more with traffic, but there just wasn't time to take him during the week. Anyway, deep in my heart, I believe that a genuine school, nasty and merciless as it could be, was still better than Garland Farm. Besides, nastiness was relative. After school, Cap had come home to my house, where Sophie was there to demonstrate the true meaning of nasty. She hated Cap Anderson with a passion that I wouldn't have believed her capable of, and I was her mother. Even when he did things that had nothing to do with Sophie, she took them personally. His healthy vegetarian diet she considered a slap in the face to her own eating habits. His neatness was a deliberate ploy to make her appear messy. She couldn't bear that Cap woke up early to practice Tai Chi on our front lawn. But Sophie, I tried to reason, why would it matter to you? You're barely awake at that hour. It's humiliating, she raged. You might as well put a sign on the roof that says, Warning, mutant on premises. The next morning, when Cap was performing the dance-like martial art moves by the dogwood bushes, my darling daughter emptied an entire wastebasket full of water down onto his head. This she followed with a string of language that would have set fire to the sidewalk. All from the girl who was so concerned about what the neighbors might think. He looked up at her and he smiled, instead of heaving a rock through her window, which is what I would have done. Oh, what a sight he was, with all the hair hanging limply around his shoulders. He looked like a weeping willow in soggy sandals. According to Sophie, the entire accident was my fault. By bringing Cap into our home, I had left her no choice but to take matters into her own hands. Since Sophie was never going to apologize to Cap, I did it myself. "I'm so sorry, dear," I said, handling him a towel that wouldn't have dried one-tenth of his abundant hair. "You have to forgive Sophie, although I can't think of a reason why." He looked sad. "She doesn't like me." I smiled. 16-year-old girls don't like anybody. His answer brought me straight back to my Garland days. When you're unkind to others, it's usually because you don't believe that you yourself deserve kindness. "Don't be so nice," I said. "She can be pretty mean." In her defense, she's been through a lot in the last couple of weeks. Her father, my ex-husband, his heart's been in the right place, but he makes a lot of promises he can't keep. And Sophie ends up caught in the middle. Just yesterday, she was waiting for him to pick her up for her first driving lesson. He never showed up. That's him. Doesn't come, doesn't call, dead air. He won't admit it, but she's devastated. He looked thoughtfully. I guess when you have a lot of people in your life, there's more of a chance that someone will let you down. I laughed. You're right, but it's a risk most of us are prepared to take. Captus looked dubious. He had grown up with exactly one person in his life, Rain. And regardless of what I thought of her, to him, she had been as constant as the rising sun. How terrifying it must be to lose that. That's it for Chapter 7, and tomorrow for Chapter 8 of Schooled by Gordon Corman. See you next time on Amazing Videos!